Bay, the founding chair and scientific director of the McGill Center for the Convergence of Health and Economics, and also the James McGill Chair in Consumer and Lifestyle Psychology at the Desautels Faculty of Management. This webinar series, the Convergent Innovation Webinar Series, is part of research and action activity that we have been engaging, taking the food sector as the privileged domain of action for inventing essentially this convergence innovation, which is about bridging cutting-edge science, technology, and innovation in agriculture, food, and health, and weaving this through a deep understanding of both human behavior and organizational behavior, with the objective of building more convergence of what we do on the economic side of life in a way that also contribute to human and environment health. The Global Pulse Innovation Platform, that was the first of such AI platform, was launched in 2016 on the occasion of the year of the United Nations declaring 2016 the International Year of Pulse. And we have seen move to other type of commodity, other type of food, and progressively capitalizing of the power of AI and digital technology, both to better capture this complex dynamic, and then to weave this into innovation, intervention, and so on. So I'm extremely pleased today to welcome Beena, who is the principal scientist of health and head of physical science research at the Tata Consulting Service, headquartered in Chennai, I believe, and with a whole network around the world. Beena is a PhD from one of the India premier research institutions, National Chemical Laboratory, and she joined TCS 2 decades ago. And a research on computational model of sensors and weaving this into innovation is extremely relevant, not only to academic agenda, but as many countries around the world, including Canada, are trying to reinvent agriculture and food innovation. Her work is extremely important at this point in time. So I am pleased to welcome her in this presentation, Simulating Sensors at TCS, a confluence of physics-based modeling, data science, and IT. TCS has been close partner of MCCHG and all the FCI platform for more than 2 years now, and it's with extreme pleasure that I'm welcoming Beena today. Beena, before I shift to Beena, just a bit of modus operandi. We mute everybody during the time of the presentation that are typically 15 minutes or so, and then we have a solid 30 minutes for discussion. If you have question that you want to convey through the web, send them during the talk, and we will start the discussion with my one or two opening questions. Then Sabina will go through the questions she may have had on the chat box, and then we will open the floor to everybody for questions. Okay, thank you very much, everybody, to be here this morning and or this evening, depending on where you are in the world. And Beena, welcome. I'm shifting to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Dubey, for the kind introduction. And good morning, good evening to people who have ever joined from different places from the globe. The topic for today's discussion, as Laura pointed out, is basically we are going to learn about how digital technologies can be used to either understand senses or augment senses. But before I jump off to the topic, I would like to introduce me as well as the TCS Research and Innovation. TCS is actually a global IT company, and we have a big, you can say, function in TCS Research and Innovation. And we believe in open innovation. We know that innovations cannot be done sitting in silos. So we have a large ecosystem. Of course, one side we have our customers, and on the other side we have tried to reach out to outside world, include that actually includes academia as well as the startup community, emerging technology, and so on. We have actually categorized our research in various themes. So we have research areas doing early stage research in core domains. And then once we see the proof of concept, we take the idea to execution and then further scale up. And that's where we turn research ideas into research programs. So at given point in time, there are several programs and many core research areas exist in TCS research, and it's pretty dynamic, it keeps changing. And we in fact have global presence. So TCS R&I actually has recently started a new venture called TCS Space, where we are trying to build actually this ecosystem closer to our partners, be it academic partners, be a customer, and also bringing in the technology available in the market. So, and we also have plans of opening such things in Canada. So I represent, actually I head one of the research areas which works at the interface of computing and materials, called physical sciences. And in this research area, our focus is actually to understand materials behavior from first principles, wherever it is possible. So we are actually simulating behavior of materials from right from electronic scale to macro scale, and trying to see that how things are changing, what is happening, how the material properties is impacted by things happening at very, very, you can say, micro scale to macro scale. As well as we also looking at the engineering side of materials, where we want to see or convert them into product. The goal here is that to bring in as much science, as much as understanding and knowledge into the process, so that you can lead to actually the kind of circular economy for kind of materials we are looking at. We look at both, you can say, living and non-living materials. When I say living, it could be a human organ, which we are also trying to understand, which is going to be one of the topics when I discuss going forward. And currently there are many other things happening in the research area. For example, we are looking into waste recycling, we are working on the advanced materials, and so on and so forth. But for today's agenda, we have picked up the topic where we are going to talk about that how can one actually leverage digital technologies to do two things. The first thing I'm going to talk about is, if you look at the basic senses like touch, taste, smell, vision, and hearing, always people would like to understand how things happen at that in the real system, in the human system. So if we understand the mechanisms happening in biological systems, and can we build models understanding the science, so basically converting science into the digital form, so that now you can create a replica of the organ into a computer, that is what we are looking at. And once if you are able to do that, there are many applications you can look at it. The second part we are looking at, that these are the basic senses which we have got as humans, but can I augment these senses using the technologies, be it novel sensors or be it a kind of sensing platform, and then augment these senses and understand the behavior of material we are looking at. For today's thing, we have looked at food as one of the material. And then if you are able to understand the behavior, then of course you can then do a lot many things. So these are the two kind of threads which I am going to talk today. And so let's start with the first one, where we talk about human skin digital twin. So here the idea is that if we are able to capture the behavior of skin in digital form, then we have a in silico or you say digital twin of skin. And once I have the skin, then I can do a lot many things with it. So let's see, how can we build this digital twin of skin and how difficult or complex or easy it is and where we are. So before I jump onto the what the digital skin would look like, let's look at why TCS is interested or why anybody would be interested in building such platform. As we all know, skin is actually the second largest organ of our body after intestine and easily accessible. And it also performs a lot of functions. So it is very critical to our, you can say, existence. But not only that, it also has a lot of business potential. I'm sure all of us know that both personal care or cosmetic industries as well as pharma industry, they leverage skin. The market is pretty big. More and more people are going towards a lot of skincare products are in the market. Every day we see new products. And this is the age of, you can say, cosmeceuticals. Similarly, if you look at the pharmaceutical industry, transderma delivery is a very easy route. You don't have to inject. You can just apply things on the skin and easily goes in the body. That's it. And also there are a lot many things which you can avoid when you're doing transderma delivery. So there are a lot of benefits in leveraging skin. But if you look at the challenge side, the challenges are also pretty large. And that's why it has not been leveraged so far the way it should have been. For example, if you look at cosmetic industry, the regulations are coming, new and new regulations are actually banning testing of products on animals. So one has to find a solution for it. So you cannot in fact develop new products if you cannot test it. Similarly, if you look at the pharma side, actually skin provides a very strong barrier for getting things into our body. And that actually results into failure of many transdermal drug systems when they are in clinical trials. So one has to find a way of ways and means that how can you actually cleverly breach this barrier. So that's why there are very few formulations which are FDA approved and they are right now in the market. So if you look at this scenario, there is a need of a digital intervention. So far the development of these products has been primarily trial and error, experimental basis. If one can bring digital intervention, there are advantages because you can do lot many experimentation and you can reduce time and cost to market, as well as you can mitigate some of the regulatory requirements. For example, you can do in silico testing and avoid animal testing. So if you look at now skin is a multi-layer organ, and if we talk about things are getting into our skin or transport of molecules across the skin, there are different layers which offer different kinds of barriers. If you look at the top layer, actually that's the main barrier which one has to breach when you want to deliver things into the skin. If we look closely into this barrier, actually this is top layer is called something called stratum corneum, and which is what is shown in the figure here. So if we now look at stratum corneum further and zoom in, actually we'll see that this looks like a bricks and mortar structure. And if you see here, the bricks are some corneocytes which are actually impervious. So things cannot go inside through this route. But this mortar, which is actually called skin lipids, they offer the path for things to get into the skin. And if we zoom further, actually you can see these lipids are made up of three kinds of molecules, which are ceramides, fatty acids, and cholesterol. So we know the molecular arrangement and structure of this skin barrier layer. And if one can model these, then you can actually have a replica of skin barrier. But the challenge is there are 300 types of ceramides and fatty acids in our skin. So it's a fairly complex system. Now if you look at the mechanical aspect of skin, which is more, you can say, of interest to cosmetic industries. Here the layer which is of interest to is actually the middle layer, that is dermis. And that layer actually has collagen. So when we are young, this collagen is very firm and it is in right structure. So you have this very firm and nice looking skin. As with the age, there is damage happening to collagen, and that leads to the formation of wrinkles and so on and so forth. So challenge for personal care industry has been to actually repair this collagen. So if you look at, if I'm looking for transdermal drug delivery, we have to build a model which can mimic this permeation behavior of skin top layer. But if I'm looking at a cosmetic industry, I have to combine the permeation with the mechanical model so that if I apply certain cream, we have to see what happens to my collagen. So if I'm talking of digital skin, which can mimic the human skin behavior, at least we have to start from here. So if we further look into the skin barrier function, that is stratum corneum, especially the lipids, they have some certain kind of organization, and these structural organization actually lead to different properties. And these organizations happen because of the structural properties of the molecules, which you see, they form these layers. So if you look at ceramides, there are many classes of ceramides present, as I mentioned earlier. And each ceramide group actually has certain composition. And this composition varies from the place, from the, you can say, the locality of skin. For example, skin on the hand, skin on the cheek may be different. This also varies with the age. This also varies with the demography. And this also varies when there are diseases. So the model has to actually have complexity building so that you can account for all this. So, but if you have to start somewhere, so if you look at the table here, the most abundant ceramide is ceramide NS, and most abundant fatty acid is actually the C22 and 24. So to start with, what we have done is we started first building the model of the skin lipid layer. As I mentioned earlier, we have three types of molecules: ceramides, fatty acids, cholesterol. And within ceramides and fatty acids, there are many, many classes. But there are certain ceramides and fatty acids which are abundant, most abundant. So we have first started there. And we built the model from atomic scale, as you see here. And then we validated the model. And since atomic scale models take a lot of time and you need to have a model which is quick, and so that industry can use. In fact, we have done a lot of clever tricks here. We have done something called coarse graining then further. And then we have built a coarse grain model, which you see in animation that it forms the skin layer. So once we have the model in place, then of course the second step would be to validate the model. How good my model is? Is it able to capture the behavior which I see in experiments? So the slide here is showing that we built this ceramide model. And then we see we were trying to mimic some of the properties which we see in experiments. So it was able to predict actually phase transition behavior of ceramides. It was also able to predict actually the hexagonal arrangement which I talked earlier. And we also could see that what cholesterol is doing in the model. For example, we could see that when cholesterol is present in the lipid layer, actually below the transition temperature, it is making it more fluid, and above that it is making it more rigid. And these kind of observations are actually seen in experiments. I have already quoted here experimental references. So we had fair amount of confidence that yes, model is capturing the behavior which we want to see. Further, more validation, we experimentally, it is reported that cholesterol is sitting between ceramide and fatty acids, and we also see same thing when we do this density plots are shown here. We also see that cholesterol actually leads to rigidity, and more fatty acids lead to flexibility, and that also is in line with experimental observation. We, as I mentioned earlier, there are many types of ceramides, so we also model various chain lengths of ceramides, again looked at their behavior, which again is very much in line with experimental observation. If you increase the chain length, actually the layer becomes more rigid, that means less permeable. And if you look at the experimental data, actually the higher chain length ceramides are leading to less water loss from the skin. So basically they are less permeable. So in principle, so it, in a way, it is actually capturing the trend which we are seeing in the experiment. So once we have done the model, if you recall, again, I have put this bricks and mortar structure. We talked about lipid layer, And as we see this lipid layer model, which I showed you, which is right now running in animation, you have only two bilayers. But actually in skin, there are multi-layers. And after that, actually, you have many of such layers connected. So there is a path. So what we need to do is now we have to connect this molecular level model to macro scale model. So that is what we have done. You can put a drug or a molecule and compute diffusivity. So that is what the plot is showing. We have done diffusivity for three kinds of drugs. And once you have these diffusivity values, we have built a macro scale model where these D values are used to compute the flux of the molecules inside the skin. So that is what is shown here in the plot. You have these dotted lines are experiments for this, and then simulation. So experiments are able to capture. So now we can quantify that how much amount of drug or molecule will get into the skin, and we will be able to match it with the experiment. So now we have bridged. So it's a multi-scale model, which we have started from atomistic to molecular to, you can say, mesoscale, and finally the macro scale. As I mentioned earlier, that composition of skin varies across our body. So if you look at face versus hand, there are different compositions of fatty acids, ceramides, and cholesterol. And now our model is able to capture. So we have in fact built models for other classes of ceramides as well, even though first we started with ceramide NS, and again validated these models with experimental data. So now we have models. So if we want to customize or personalize a model for a given individual or given part of the body or for a given demography, we can do that. So we can have a personalized skin model for each case we are trying to address. So far I just talked about the development of model, transport model, the journey from atomistic to multi-scale model. So once we have enough confidence, we have got the model, now I am going to present that how can we use this model, certain case studies. First one is actually we can use the model to figure out how safe is my formulation. Here we have looked at presence of ethanol in formulation. Ethanol is widely used in many of the personal care as well as drug formulation. For example, even hand sanitizer has ethanol into it. And what we are showing here is that if you take ethanol and you run simulation, you see the model after, if you increase the certain concentration of ethanol, actually ethanol starts to extract fatty acids. Means actually it is damaging our skin. So there is a kind of, you can say, correlation how much ethanol you can put into your formulation, which is safe because it is making the bilayer disturb, as you can see from other parameters. And it also shows that actually it is extracting more of fatty acids than the ceramides. So this actually kind of gives you a leeway to design a safer formulation where you are within the limit of acceptable limit of ethanol so that they don't damage your skin. So next case study is we have looked into permeation enhancers. Permeation enhancers are actually class of molecules which are used in formulation to increase the delivery of things across the skin. If the molecule of interest by itself is not able to permeate well, then we add this molecule to make the skin permeable for temporary duration so that molecule can get in. So again, we have modeled permeation of various classes of molecules across the skin and try to correlate this with experimental data. And experimental data here we are looking at something called enhancement ratio, where if you keep the skin with this kind of permeation enhancers and then you see that how much actually it is disrupting the SE, stratum corneum, that is making the skin more permeable. And you see a very good correlation between experimental observation and the computed property, that is inverse of other parameters. So again, model is able to predict. So this can be used for in silico design of, you can say, better permeation enhancer for a given molecule of interest. The next one we look at fullerene. Fullerenes are again additives which are used in many personal care formulation. And we have done systematic studies to see that how much fullerene can be tolerated. inside your formulation. As you see in the simulation screenshots, after certain concentration, you see that fullerene starts to agglomerate inside the skin, and then permeation drops, as you see in the plot. So there is an optimum concentration up to which you can add these molecules into your formulation. And if you look at the experimental data, which was done by other, actually Martins et al., they in fact, these do see the agglomeration of fullerene inside the skin. So model, our model prediction was actually beforehand, and this experimental data was published later on. So actually model is able to predict the behavior which is seen in the experiment. So once we have the model, we also see that model is able to help us in design formulation. So we move more towards designing formulation, especially from the interest of delivering, say, biomolecules inside the skin. And it is known from the literature that nanoparticles can penetrate skin. So we have in fact developed an in silico framework, which allows us first to design nanoparticles for given shape, size, different kinds of, you can say, surface hydrophobicity, hydrophilicity, coated with the certain molecules, that means charge versus neutral particles. So this framework actually can help you digitally design the kind of nanoparticles you are looking at. And once you have the nanoparticle in place, then you can also see how stable my formulation would be. So this is what is shown here in this chart. Basically, it shows that charge particles are more stable because we look at the free energy calculations, and if you have neutral particles, they agglomerate. So you can use this framework to design the kind of particle you are looking at. You can also, once you have the particle, now again we bring in skin model and see how the particle is getting into the skin. Here you see gold nanoparticle goes very easily in the skin. That has been observed in the experiment as well. There is a relationship between the penetration versus size of the particle. So there's been a size optimum till what size you can take the particle which will go inside the skin. Interestingly, model also shows that once you have the particle in, it actually deforms a bilayer, but once you take the particle out, actually the layer self-heals. That means there is no damage is happening to skin. So particles can be used as a safer vehicle to take things inside. We have also looked into neutral charge. As I mentioned, you can now create all kinds of particles. So here the simulation shows that if you have a neutral particle, you are able to deliver things into the skin. That is shown from the energy calculation as well as experiment shows that. And if you have a charged particle, actually it is remaining on the outer surface of the skin. It is not getting into the skin. So model is able to capture this behavior as well. We also have, now you can design hypothetical nanoparticles. That's what we have done. Different kinds of, you can say, surface properties you can have on the particle, hydrophilic versus hydrophobic. And once you have these designer particles, which one you compute this free energy of permeation in the skin, and you select the best one, and now take the best particle and see whether it will take the protein in. And here a simulation shows, yes, that gold nanoparticle is actually binding to the protein and taking it inside. We have also actually tweaked the model to understand the effect of electric field on the skin. And electroporation is also one mode of therapy to develop things, to deliver things inside the skin. And model is able to actually predict if you apply certain voltage for certain amount of time, what kind of force are you going to create. In fact, force gets created for transient time, then they seal as it is shown in the simulation. And once you have certain force, you can manipulate the pore size as per the molecule of interest you are trying to put in, so that you don't damage the skin, but you deliver the drug. So the model can help you design the therapy as well using electroporation. So far I talked about transporting things across the skin. If you recall, I talked about there are two kinds of models required. One is for transport, and there is for mechanical strength of the skin. So we are also building mechanical model of the skin, where we have started with a very simple one-dimensional model looking at viscoelastic properties of skin. We have used this spring and dashboard model, and we were able to capture the behavior of young versus old skin as seen in the experiment. And we have also looked at when skin is actually coated with say a polymer or maybe a formulation, which could be a screen or moisturizing lotion, how the behavior is changing. So the model is able to capture that as well as seen in the experiment. We are also able to capture that if skin is getting, because the collagen, I talked about this collagen breakage, so that also we have incorporated in the model. So this model is very preliminary yet, it is able to capture the behavior. So now the next step would be that we have, if you agree with me that we have now a skin transport model, which is fairly evolved, which is able to capture how things are getting inside the skin and what kind of manipulation you can do to deliver things inside the skin. And it can be used for design of formulation and so on and so forth. We also have a simple yet, you can say, realistic model of mechanical part of skin. Now the challenge is that can I combine both the models so that if I suppose I deliver a say a fatty acids or a hydroxy acid in my personal care formulation, I would also like to see what happens to skin mechanical behavior. So currently we are working on that part. The framework is shown here. Basically, how do you combine these two models? And second ask would be that right now I have talked about transport across only stratum corneum, that's the topmost layer of skin. But how, once the drug gets into the skin, what is the absorption? How it gets into systemic circulation, that's another model. So deeper layer of the model is still to be built. So our efforts are currently on these two directions, getting into deeper layer of skin as well as combining the transport and mechanical model. So after the journey of skin, let's move to another sense, that is taste, and that is more relevant to probably this forum because we are talking about food here. And if you look at flavor industry, again, a multi-billion dollar industry, both from food industry as well as even in pharmaceuticals, these bitter maskers are the big market. And of course, certain disease conditions, for example, in many people have diabetes and then they have to go off sugar. So the sugar substitutes also is a big business. And also a lot of people are worried about calories, so people are moving towards artificial sweetener. So from market point of view or business point of view, there's a lot of interest in flavor industry. But if you look at the current scenario, whether you look at say, even just you look at artificial sweetener, new and new products are coming into market. Again, largely as I described in the skin, basically pharma and personal care, largely trial error, experimental and knowledge driven kind of work happens here. New molecules are tried, tested, laborious experiments. The digital intervention in these areas are still very minimal. So again, there is a lot of scope. So drawing analogy from a skin journey, we started looking at taste from the basic fundamentals first. So if you look at, there are five basic tastes: sweet, salt, sour, bitter, and umami. And generation, or you can say origin of this taste, is into our taste buds, which are located in our tongue. And if you again zoom in further, these taste buds, they have again this membrane where these receptors sit. And these receptors, actually these receptors of various kinds of receptors are there. And if you see them further, for sweetness, there's a very particular receptor. For bitter, there's a receptor. For umami, there's a receptor. So this mechanism at molecular scale is again known, because these receptors have very well-defined structure. And this sweet molecule, which gives a sweet taste, actually goes and binds with the receptor and generates the signal that is perceived by the nerve and goes to brain. And we think that it's a sweet food or sweet taste. So since we know the molecular mechanism, we can again model things. So that's the hypothesis. So there are two ways we can do it. One is, of course, we can do the way we did for skin. You model the whole system, you model the receptor, you see how the binding is happening, and then you can design things which binds better, which gives better. You can quantify sweetness. Of course, another route is, there is a lot of data one can look into. Combining the structure with the properties, that is QSAR kind of modeling, And this is much simpler, whereas this building the whole physics model is actually again complex, but more robust. So we started first with the simpler one. We said, okay, let's look at the data. So there's one case study I'm presenting. We looked at the sweetness. We have taken a database of around 500 molecules, which have various kind of sweetness varying from 0.2 to say 220 K sweetness index. And then we have applied the standard data analytics techniques here. We have tried to quantify structure properties using various descriptors. And then using machine learning techniques, we have built models. And as you see, both the models actually predict very well. So now we have a model which can be used to predict the sweetness of the new molecule. So the next step is basically, how can we, now we have a model which is already validated. Now we can apply this model on the known databases, or you can also do in silico design of molecules, run through the model and screen them. So that is the first part. But once you have screened the molecules, we can take to the more physics-based model which I talked about, that is the receptor. So we are also working on that part. We have started looking into sweet receptor first. So once you have screened the molecule, then how it is going to, that's where this molecular modeling happens, how it is going to bind with the receptor, what is the affinity, and then actually see whether it's going to be good molecule or bad. So you also have to look at the toxicity part of it. So there is something called ADMET model will come into play. And finally, you go for testing in the laboratory. So these are the steps, and this is the kind of framework which currently we are working. First steps only we have made, and then there are some steps which are going on. And eventually, this framework will allow us to design test ends as per the requirement completely in the digital space. The third part in this segment is talking about smell. When we talk about smell, we have not looked into the, again, physics space where we start modeling the olfactory senses in our nose. We have taken a position that we will first go with the database road. But before we jump onto that, we have tried to look into what is the market and what's the need. So if you look at smell, as opposed to say, if we talk about say vision, or if you talk about say hearing, there are measures where you can quantify this. For example, you can use wavelength of light for vision, you can use frequency of sound for hear. But if you talk about olfactory perception, there is no such standard measure. Actually, it's very behavioral or very perceptive, means very human dependent. So that's why that's the main problem. It's a very complex and subjective response you get it, because similar molecules may be perceived very differently by two set of people. And so the fragrance classification, even though there is some you can say ambiguous classification which industry is using based on the intensity and character of the fragrance as shown here in this pyramid, but still a lot of things are very empirical here. So it is very difficult to understand what exactly is happening. And that's where probably we feel that if you bring in latest digital, or you can say technology, probably that may help. And if you look at this pyramid, there are like, if you classify, there are some kind of basic fragrances, then middle notes, and then top notes. And if one is designing a perfume, they have to always worry, it has to be a proper balance of these three kinds of notes. And as you move up in the pyramid, actually things are more expensive. As you move down, they are cheaper. So again, there's a lot of play required to come up with a new formulation. So this whole recipe design is basically an art. And there are people who have been doing this for many, many years, and they are able to, in fact, mix and match things. But there's very little science put into it. So further going on this, there is a need to, in fact, understand chemistry and relate it to order relationships. That order chemistry structure relationship is a need. And there are some attempts where people, there are like, if you look at the chemical viewpoint, their molecule has to be volatile and so on, for low molecular weight, it should dissolve in oil and so on. So similarly, from biochemical point of view, there are things that it should solubilize in olfactory mucus and so on. So And based on this hypothesis, people have been actually designing products. If you look at the history of actually odor, or you can say fragrances, it used to be earlier mostly natural product based, and then it used to be very expensive. Then with the advent of synthetic fragrances, it reached to common people, and then many people started buying it because it became cheaper, it became simpler to in fact make and mimic these fragrances. But still the question remains to be asked that if you make a new fragrant, how do you quantify, what will be the intensity, what will be the smell like, how do you characterize and quantify? These two are still challenging. So we just started looking into it. So this is one of, you can say, the very initial studies which I have just put in here, where we have looked into data where 55 subjects. So this is bringing the behavioral or psychophysical aspects, means how it is linked to actually our sensory perception. That's the key thing here. So, and then they were exposed to, say, various fragrances, and they were asked to qualify these fragrances, and that data we have just plotted using one of our proprietary visualization tools. And here we see, so here if you look at the size of the circles, actually they are denoting the pleasantness, and the color is showing the familiarity of that particular fragrance. And if you see that, if you look at the number 11, the size is actually largest, that means the most pleasant. And also we look at the color, so it is also top, that means it is familiarity. So people know this, and also people rated that it is also most pleasant and most known to them. So they have known this reference. Whereas if you look at the number 5, here actually it is not known to them, familiarity is also low, and also it is not very pleasant. So if one can enhance, suppose if I take this group number 5, or if I can enhance the pleasantness, so it is not familiar but more pleasant, then you can come up with the new fragrances there. So that's the kind of, you can say, insight you get from this this data, and you can further drill down on the data and see that within this 11 number group, what are the kinds of molecules which actually are more pleasant, more familiar, and so on and so forth. So that becomes your baseline to go ahead and take the structure and then design new molecules around that and come up with a more novel formulation. So we are, in fact, it's a very new work. We just started looking into it, and then we are on this journey. Okay, so that completes my first part of the seminar, where we talked about how can I leverage digital technologies to build models of, you can say, basic senses. Now the second part talks about that, as if you look at food, as a human we use these 5 senses to in fact understand food, but can I also now augment these sensing using the second layer here? That means I can put sensors, I can have maybe invasive, non-invasive sensing of the food, so that I can augment it further. And then while augmenting, I can also use technologies like Internet of Things, put data into cloud, do data analytics, machine learning, create digital thread of the whole value chain or supply chain. And by doing so, we can do lot many things. We can have smart supply chain. We can, in fact, reduce lot of food wastage. We can ascertain the quality, freshness of food. And we can also prevent toxicity of food. So this is the second part, where I'm going to just talk about what we are doing in this space. So if you look at food wastage, why one should worry about it? Because it's a global problem. Lots and lots of food goes waste, whereas many people remain hungry. And if you look at some of the charts, like if you look at the developed countries like America and Europe, here the wastage is at the consumer level. That means society is such that people don't care. Whereas if you look at country like Southeast Asia, here actually the wastage is happening in the supply chain. At the consumer level, wastage is very, very low. So people are very conscious, because these are large populations, so people have to worry about food. Whereas other side, it's a totally opposite. And if you look, even if you see this chart, where you see even China, India, and as opposed to US, if in terms of total amount of food wastage is very large in China and India as well, because our population is very large. So these are staggering numbers. So one has to worry about that somehow you have to in fact reduce this wastage as much as possible and food should reach to the needy people. So there are also a lot of targets, regulations are coming into play. So we are working on developing this, you can say IoT enabled or food freshness monitoring framework, which will help us understand the condition of food in real time as it is traversing from say farm to the final consumer. So if you look at food's value chain, the place it is produced from there, it is harvested, packaged, maybe processed, distributed, and finally consumer. So if one can track what is happening to food by sensing the environment, and then also then predict that if this is likely to in fact perish in this much time, then probably you have to repurpose it or do something about it so that you can prevent the losses. It will save a lot of money and you can save food as well. So this is the kind of platform we have just started to build. So it's a multimodal sensing platform where you are trying to sense various environmental parameters, humidity, temperature, various kinds of gases. We are trying to take pictures, so you can also do a lot of image analytics and so on and so forth. This is all online data coming in, but we are also parallelly doing, you can say, invasive testing when you do a lot of tests for nutrients value in the lab. Combine all this data. Of course, this data can be IoT enabled, put on the cloud, and then in fact to be it can be seen remotely and so on and so forth. And once you have got the data, build algorithm, develop models, and then predict the freshness. So that's the kind of framework. And some case studies we have just started to build, so I will just present two case studies here. We have looked at banana, so we are trying to look at the freshness of banana. So same chem, what I talked about the framework, we have all these sensors built into it. You have data coming in, and then you have this models running in the back end, and then of course you have whether it's good, bad, or something you can qualify. So there are a lot of, you can say, this back processing of data happening, and then it is giving you kind of, you can say, final outcome, whether it's good or bad. So we are sensing gases, we are sensing temperature, light, and image, and so on and so forth. So another one, we looked at potatoes, because again, potatoes are, you can say, fourth largest food crop grown. And India also produces a lot of potatoes. And of course, they also are the main ingredients in chips manufacturing. And a lot of post potato goes waste because it's a seasonal crop. One has to, if you are looking for chips manufacturing, you have to source it and store it. And during storage, the losses are very high. And so one has to worry about, because if you have high humidity, you may have these kind of problems happening, fungal growth, hot conditions, they may lose weight, and then in dark and light, they do a lot of sprouting. In fact, the sprouting, these green sprouts are very, very toxic. In fact, they're poisonous. And sometimes the high sugar in potato also leads to this acrylamide, which leads to carcinogenic substances and so on and so forth. So we have envisioned, again, sensing these kind of parameters where we are looking into weight loss, we are looking into sprouting, changing color, and we are also looking at these nutrient values, like how the starch is changing to sugar and so forth, and then what is the effect, how the moisture is changing. And we have in fact measured all this data, captured using this sensor, and then try to build model. For example, if we have looked at first the weight loss data with respect to temperature and humidity, and we have built the model. So now that model can actually predict that if potato is stored at a this condition, how long it is going to last. So that's what is shown here. It is able to predict the shelf life. And the industry accepts 15% weight loss. So if I have to store under these two conditions, and if my target is 15% weight loss, so one condition will last for 29 days, another condition, it will last for 22 days. So these kind of predictions you can make. We have also looked at like various things we are doing. So if you look at if change in humidity actually is good, because you can see that at higher humidity the weight loss is lower, and so on and so forth. Similarly, we have looked at different temperature conditions. So after doing a lot of experiments, we have come up with now this optimal conditions. If one has to store potato and if you look at all the parameters, then probably this is the best condition. So 5 degrees centigrade and 90% humidity is the best condition where you are able to measure. So green here shows that you are in permissible limit for all the things. Yellow is somewhat acceptable, whereas red is not. So this is the best condition. So basically the framework allows you to not only predict the shelf life, but also to optimize your storage condition so that you can enhance the storage life. So this is where we are in this, and then of course a repercussion of this would be that once it is implemented across the supply chain, you can actually reduce a lot of food wastage. You can also actually have a lot of visibility and accountability because it is being traced at all the stations from the produce to the final consumption stage. And of course, there are many more things you can do. For example, you can look into ripening of fruits. For example, instead of using chemicals, you can use natural way of ripening because you are sensing gases. These gases have effect on natural ripening and so on and so forth. You can also look how you can enhance or retain nutritional value, so because you can manipulate the storage condition so that the food is not losing that and so on. So with that, actually I come to the end of my talk, and just to in fact recapitulate and summarize what I have talked or tried to articulate is, the first is that the first part actually talked about how can one leverage digital to understand the science part, science behind these senses. For example, I talked about digital skin, I talked about understanding or decoding taste, I talked about how can we understand the perception of smell and so on and so forth. The basic thing here was that can I capture these mechanisms in digital form and build digital replicas of these sensory organs. It's a complex thing, but you have to start making steps by step and then probably reach there. The second part, of course, I also talked about that even though humans have these senses, we can augment these senses by putting technologies like IoT and sensors, and then collect lots and lots of data. And then this data can be used to build science or knowledge. So that's the second part. That's where you can then create digital threads, where we talked about food freshness monitoring and so on and so forth. So these two things basically lead to digital twins and threads, and that's where I believe we have to move if we are talking about sustainable world and future. And of course, how can we augment these things more? So the third part here would be that can we also augment our sensing capabilities using augmented reality and virtual reality. This will probably help us understand the science as well as visualize data, which we are not able to do with the current technology. For example, here I show the same skin model which just we saw, we have also implemented in virtual reality, where we sitting for, and we can, it is also hosted remotely, so that if we want to see with the same three locations we are sitting and we want to see how this molecule is going to penetrate in the skin, we all can go to the virtual world and manipulate things simultaneously and see things happening at one go. So this will help us in collaborative formulation design, understanding more complex physics and biology. So that's where the, I would say, future is going. So with that, let me thank you. In fact, the thank you also you see is actually molecular simulation, which leads to the simulated data and said thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, Beena. Spectacular work and very interesting presentation. As I had announced, I will have a couple of questions. And then, Sabina, let me know by email if there is an online question. And then we'll open the floor.
I'm not sure I understand.
Sorry. It is my Apple that was answering instead of Sabina. So the question I have for you is that when we look at the senses, and I'm asking the question one at a time, and how together, in fact, human experience at any point in time is a combination of at least two or three of those. So how far are we in terms of validating the actual, you get the prediction at the level of the objective aspect, but how far are we in terms of being confident that it captures a very strong predictive quality of the human experience, and what other factors happen between the biology and that experience? So that's my first question.
Yeah. So yes, you are very right that quite often two or three senses, they work together. For example, even if we talk about, say, food, it's not only taste, it's a combination of flavor, it's a combination of vision as well. So all three senses work together when we are eating food. So if you talk, if you ask me from first principle, whether we can combine all three senses, it's still very far to go. But since I pointed about this VR, AR technologies where you can augment the senses, probably those technologies can be brought in, and artificially we can bring the second senses there. So that would be way forward. But from first principle, bringing three senses together is still very far.
Okay. And the other question before we open to the floor, Sabina is telling me that there's no question from the chat room, so you can send if you have. The other question I had is, we talk about nanotechnology and advanced material and so on, but I have been working with the pulse sector for many years, and I've been hearing many, many times the beany flavors of many pulses. So how can this approach be used to guide? Currently, a lot of genomics work is done for nutrition, is done for yield, is done for carbon captation. How can we really use such computational model to help nature in some way to be more acceptable in dimensions of taste or other sensory, because it seems to be a major limitation for pulses in their integration, primarily into the food processing pipeline. Can you help nature?
Means you are talking about how can I augment the taste of pulses using technology.
Yeah, so and working so at the level of the biology of pulses itself, could we a priori explore the genomics pattern that will be addressing those issues without engaging in very, very extensive development process?
I don't know, because genomics is not my field, but I don't know whether we can do that. But of course, if you talk about nanotechnology point of view, probably you can incorporate certain coatings into your in food or whatever, and then maybe improve the mask the flavor of pulses, because people don't accept pulses, and you can enhance the flavor by adding flavoring agents. I mean, that's the only thing comes to my mind. From genetic point of view, I don't know, I'm not qualified to talk about, because I don't work in genomics area. But in drawing analogy from what we have done from skin, I don't know whether we can do things model at in the plant scale and see how things are getting into there, and how can you add more nutritional value, which leads to actually different flavor. I don't know.
Okay. Is there a question from the floor? For those of you who know me, I always have plenty of questions, but let's open. Sabina, the process is that you unmute everybody, or those who want to talk unmute themselves? Sabina?
Yes, I had to unmute myself. Well, I feel that I would rather unmute person by person, so it's easier if they indicate to me, MCCHE, that they would like to speak and I can unmute, or they can unmute themselves. It creates less
Okay, so they can unmute themselves as I did. So is there any questions from the floor?
Claire sent ask a question and I send this to your email.
Okay. Claire sent, could you discuss the potential of enabling nutrition absorption in humans via compounds such as encapsulated enzyme beta propeller fetas? That's the question.
Hello.
Yeah.
So actually, if I understand the question, you are talking about increasing the absorption of certain nutrient in through our body.
Yeah. Potential of enabling nutrition absorption in human via compounds.
Okay. So we in fact have just embarked on building the model of intestine as well. So how things, just like we have built for skin layer, we are also looking at absorption through intestinal wall. So similar modeling concept we are in fact extending, where we can look at how things are going to be absorbed. So we have some understanding of the mechanism, how things are going there. In principle, we can also build this mucus model in the mouth as well. So the principles are same, but of course these are fairly complex model to build. I mean, the skin model which I presented took us 5 years to make. So, but yes, in principle, it's possible. The intestinal one we have already started.
Thank you, Claire. Does it answer your question? Yes.
Okay. All right. I'm not sure if you can hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you now, Claire. Does it answer your question?
Potential of that technology is.
Well, we don't hear you. Okay, we may continue by the chat box to Sabina. Meanwhile, I have another question for you, in the sense that I was very interested by your last development on food waste and looking at the parameters of the food, of the processing. And so I'm intrigued to hear a bit more specifics about the actual modeling behind this and the type, because you are operating now in a very, very large number of scales. So if you could give a bit more more information on this, and how far are we in terms of being able really to capture all those different type and parameter and scale of operation, and how far are we from bringing this to the market at a price that the value chain in the market can afford in a way that makes sense?
Yeah, so for that part, so far we have just built a lab prototype, a kind of closure, which is a sensor suit, and then coupled with, you can say, this models. But the idea here is, because if you want to really replicate this sensor suits everywhere in whole supply chain, which may be very expensive to do, we are thinking of doing this offline sensing. That means you do sensing in the lab, build this model, and we call them actually soft sensors. And these soft sensors can be used to predict throughout the supply chain. So that will be more affordable way of doing, rather than building this. So a lot of people are working about building these sensors and embedding them in throughout the supply chain as the food is traversing, which is going to be expensive, unless you really get sensors which are few cents and then you are able to integrate them and so on and so forth. Best would be that for a class of food, if you can actually capture this, how you sense, and then you are able to in fact build these models which act as a sensor, then you can have need not have sensors all over the place, but you can have sensors which are minimum requirements, and they sense the environment, feed into this soft model which is already there in your cloud, and then you are able to predict it. So it will be a combination of, you can say, the sensing online, which is happening in the supply chain, with a combination of offline sensing, which has happened with the historical data, then you have built soft sensors. And that's where it will be, you can be scalable and affordable to really put in the market. Otherwise, it is going to be tough. I mean, that's what we feel. But if you ask where we are, I would say we have just taken a baby step. So we have not even spent a year into this. Last we met, Laurette, I had discussed about you, and after that, in fact, we started on this journey. So I would say it's very initial stages, but this is what our thought process is.
And Claire, maybe if you can talk, I will pick your brain here. Because I do know that you are working also on intelligent packaging. So solution maybe in the processing per se, in the food, in the packaging, and all those various angles. So I would like to, Claire, if you can react to have a bit of your comment there. But the question I will have for both of you is that will this be ever available just for the large organization, or can we think of a way to make such technology available in a much more accessible and distributed manner? Because it can be really transformational for sustainability and environment. Claire, do you want to address?
Yes, but can you hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Oh, fantastic. Yes. I actually agree with what Beena said. Putting these types of technologies, which we've had for many years, in packaging is very expensive, and it's been cost prohibitive. But I really like her idea of, and I'm not sure I understand it correct, 100% correctly, but I think what she's saying is we can put it within some of the packages, or use sort of a soft sensor approach where we have the modeling based on data and things like that, and based on the maturity of a certain, say, bananas or something like that. And then we can take that knowledge from a data set and then apply it to different situations. So I think that's a much more pragmatic approach, and one that will likely be successful.
And to both of you, how can we think about those technology in a way that is not just accessible to the larger ecosystem that is kind of more user-oriented in the way that we think about accessibility to the SME and to the smaller businesses, or even for that matter to consumers themselves, if you look at all the concern for the various parameters that drive eating those days. Beena, and then back to you, Claire, or anyone on the on this question, and then I will open for other questions as well. Now?
Yeah, so if you're talking about accessibility of this technology to even the smaller or medium enterprises, even at the consumer level. So again, my position would be that if we are able to build this soft sensor base, then with the technology, for example, you can have mobile applications which can even show the consumer. For example, you can just take a picture, or you are having some kind of very simple techniques, just you upload the picture and you see kind of thing. So there are a lot of ways such things can be done. We in fact have deployed this kind of solutions. You can say there's something called M-Krishi, which TCS developed, and which we had done for before the production of food. Actually, when farmers are growing the food, how can you give them advisory? So this was agro advisory kind of platform, which we have piloted with many, many small and marginal farmers in India. And this is using simple mobile technology. It's deploying very, very simple sensors in the field, which actually measures the pH of the soil and kind of nutrients there, and to advise them when to water, when to put, say, fertilizer, when to harvest. If there is a disease, they upload a picture. and then we in fact tell them what to spray. So this kind of agro advisory platform, and used very simple hand mobile phones, and then using this technology. And now of course we have very cheap smartphones, but this we developed a couple of years ago, and it is right now running in many, many fields, for say grape farming, for cotton farming. So in a way, yes, it can be done. There are technologies, it can be made cheap and accessible to also, you can say, smaller units and up to the consumer level.
Any comment, additional comment on this from Claire or others before we move to the next question?
Yes, this is Claire. I agree totally with the expanded value chain approach. There's been some work done, as I'm sure you know, with actually putting sensors on the product in the field and then tracing it throughout the entire system. Some of these sensors are reusable. And so that lowers the costs. And then it also balances the benefits throughout the value chain. And focusing on that is very difficult in the packaging industry, because we tend to just think of packaging from, let's say, the manufacturer to the consumer. But expanding the value chain, which you're doing very well, is the right approach, because it, again, lowers the cost, makes it more affordable for large corporations and for global populations.
Thank you. Any other comments on that question? No? Is there any other question from the floor before I come back with one of mine? You just unmute yourself. I will go with one of mine then. The potential of this can be very, very interesting for ingredient formulation as well as for product formulation. And in many product categories, your innovation or your existing is a combination of what, 8, 9, 10 and more ingredients. So how could we be moving toward take one sense at a time, but relating this to what ingredient contribute what to the taste parameter that you are having? Would you be? I know that there is AI methods for product formulation, but what are your thoughts there about increasing the potential of this sensory modeling to inform product formulation?
Yes, I agree that you rightly articulated that if you're talking about formulations, it's a combination of many ingredients, and the combined effect is what we are looking at. And it's not only pure chemistry there, because if you take the example either flavor or the fragrance, actually it is also a lot of behavioral aspects come into picture. So that's what we feel, that if we really have to decode that, we have to build actually bring chemistry and physics as well as the behavioral aspect together, and then only we'll be able to have a model which will be able to kind of predict. So idea is that we have a lot of information, in the sense a lot of data is available. And there's a lot of data available with this formulation chemist, which is there in their head. So at TCS, our effort is that how can you harvest that data in form of knowledge? So we are also looking into building this knowledge base. And once we have this kind of knowledge base, then we'll be able to probably tie the things together. So that's the thought process we have. It's a fairly complex thing. And that's where people are talking about, because there's a lot of knowledge, a lot of information which is very fuzzy. So from fuzzy to technical, how do you decode? I mean, that's where even if you talk about a requirement, if you want a certain product, people say that it should smell like this, that's it. And now what that smell means to you, if as a chemist you want to put it together, then you have to decode it. So that's where a lot of, you can say, IT comes into picture or computer science comes into picture. Everything is not decoded yet. But that is what our attempt is actually. So we in fact also have kind of looking into chatbots, where we have this data and then you put your fuzzy requirements. It is able to change fuzzy requirement to actually scientifically understandable requirement, then you can also visualize. So all these kinds of tools are there which are trying to put them together and build this whole platform. So which will be your formulation, knowledge driven formulation design platform, be it for fragrance, be it for flavor. And we are saying it's a generic platform, it could be even a coating formulation and so on and so forth. But that's the attempt is right now, we don't have it ready, but that's where we are heading.
And along the behavioral side, when I saw in some of your work, you were having some measure of a psycho, you were calling them for psychophysical. So if you can elaborate a bit more, how so far you have or envision to look at behavior and linking it to biology of the person and the biology of the food, essentially. And that's where the challenge is, if we are really to... So how, in your current modeling, what I have seen, how have you been looking at the behavioral and psychological aspects so far?
So whatever I have just shown you that basically first thing here is what we understood, that it's a very small piece of work which I showed you. Because the gathering the data which captures the behavioral aspect itself is a big thing, because we don't have such data available. For example, we have to first conduct human experiments. If suppose, and say, that's where we are thinking, we being a large corporation, you know, TCS has 450,000 employees. So we can actually probably use our own database of humans to collect this data. So be it a fragrance or a, say, taste. So fragrance, for example, you give, because it's a perception, you give it to them and then try to rate them, that whether it is fruity or it's intense, mild, familiar, so on and so forth. That's the kind of database I have shown you. But there are issues here, because you have to worry about this GDPR, that if you are collecting data, what's how you are going to handle GDPR. At the same time, when you are collecting data, when humans are giving you this perceptive data, how do you standardize it? I mean, how do you decode that data? It's also a challenge for the industry, because we haven't seen it. That and so we have to build that. So we have to start this from there. So in, as you know Vivek Balraman very well, who is heading our behavioral sciences research here in Pune itself. So we are talking to Vivek and team, and from the fragrance point of view, and see whether his this agent-based modeling paradigm can be applied to develop persona. So basically, his models, they develop persona. So there may be personas of the people who perceive things, and looking at this data, can we build those personas? So now those personas become my standards to quantify or qualify, say, fragrance or taste. So that is a thought process, but we haven't really made it, but we feel it is doable and we'll be able to probably do it. So that's the kind of journey we see ourselves going forward.
Okay. Is there, let me check with the floor, otherwise I will have one closing question. Any question from the floor? You just unmute yourself. No. The question I will have is a bit more methodological, because as you know, in our team, we have been very much interested for years to linking human biology to characteristic of the environment and the physical or social aspects of this environment. So when we talk about multi-scale modeling, that is really an important domain where I believe that even in this kind of more broader scope, we may be able to learn from the multi-scale work that is done from the atom to the molecule and to the, and you already are moving some of this when you look at your food ways, where you look at some food system. So what insights can you give everybody about thinking of how, whether it's computationally or otherwise, capture a multi-scale phenomenon that where you kind of keep information on each scale where things are opening, are operating, and how all together they create a given outcome. So what are your thoughts there?
So when you talk about food, we have to see what is the multi-scale modeling we are looking in food context. If I am looking at just looking at the food itself, how these things are changing within the food at from molecular level to this thing, that is one aspect. Or if I say scales could be even the environment, plus you can say the how food is actually getting impacted by environment. So can I build those kind of multi-scale also is another thing, like the soil parameter, I mean, how it is from produced or grown in the soil to the consumption, there are also many scales. So what kind of modeling we are looking at, first we have to articulate that. If you talk about only food as a material, then it is a easier problem to tackle. But if you are talking about the other part, then it is much more difficult problem to tackle, because then the scales are very different there. But if you are talking about only food as a material, as it is transforming, probably that is an easier tractable problem.
Okay. So I do thank you very, very much, Beena, for this excellent talk, excellent work, and excellent discussion. Thanks to all of you who are there. Sabina, if you may post, we have another Food Convergence Innovation webinar next week or the week after February. You have it on the screen now, February 20th at 11, our regular time now. And this time we move to innovation in the real world. My colleague from here at McGill at the Desautels Faculty of Management, who is in strategy and entrepreneurship, about how can we innovate in a complex context, and not only in terms of innovation technological pipeline, but also how to manage that complexity if we are really to move toward better convergence between economic environment and all the other more human and social aspects. So we will welcome you at this next webinar. Meanwhile, Beena, thank you very, very much. It has been excellent. Thank you. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye-bye.